see you all. Welcome to this evening's lecture and book launch. My name is Jane Mendel, and I'm here as a friend and colleague to introduce Iain Borden and his new book, just published by Reaktion Press, called Drive, Journeys Through Film Cities and Landscapes, which hopefully we can look at in more detail after the lecture next door when we retire for drinks and maybe some book signing and selling. I'm not going to say a huge introduction, but just a few words to begin this evening. Iain, as most of you know, is Professor of Architecture and Urban Culture here at the Bartlett, and he's also Vice Dean for Communications. He's published widely in the area of architecture and urbanism, including authored works that some of you may know, his book on the seminal book, I would say, on skateboarding space in the city, and then a book that he wrote for the architects, Paul Monahan and Morris, called Manual, and also a number of edited collections, Bartlett Designs, that he worked on in 2009 with other colleagues, and then The Unknown City, Intersections, Gender Space Architecture, and also Strange and Familiar, which was probably the first collaboration that Iain and I had. We've known each other, I was thinking this morning, I think it's 20 years now. We've worked together in many different ways, teaching and also researching on projects like The Unknown City and Strange and Familiar. And when I first met Iain, he had two real passions in life. One was the fair, the work of Bonnie the fair, and the other was skateboarding. And it was Iain really who introduced me to the work of cultural geographers like Harvey and also Ed Soja, and also to the work of Henri Lefebvre. And I think the work that Iain's done around cultural space, the experience of cities, the production of space and reproduction of space has been very important within architectural history, and particularly perhaps in the context of the Bartlett within these module representations of cities, which some of you are probably taking at the moment. And that module, I think, has been quite inspirational for a number of people and kind of fed into future research and PhDs and so on that people have conducted. Around the time that Iain was avidly reading Lefebvre and digesting Lefebvre, he was also thinking and working on skateboarding. And I think this has been really interesting work around the idea of counterculture practices in urbanism and around the idea of the appropriation of space. The book has been read pretty avidly by skateboarders who wanted to understand a little bit more about what their practice means, what their urban art form means in a wider context. But I think it's also been very provocative in architectural discourse for providing a critique of what constitutes architecture. Architecture might not simply be an object, but it might also be a flow, a movement, aesthetic experiences, interactions, a visceral experience of some sort. And I think the Drive book is absolutely, in many ways, a continuation of Iain's fascination with urban movement. But I also think it marks a kind of break or a shift in his work and a new point of departure in a number of different ways, which perhaps we can tease out more in the questions after. But I think particularly, I think what's interesting for me methodologically is Iain's moved, perhaps in the skateboarding work, he was looking more at still images and quite an ethnographic method of dealing with skateboarders' words about their own practice. And I think what's happened in the Drive book, which is a really interesting new beginning of work, is the fascination with film. And film not simply as a representation of urban movement and space, but a construction of it. So I think what Iain's going to do this evening is take us through some of the ideas of the book and also show us some clips from perhaps some of his favourite film moments. So thank you very much.
How do I turn the lights down, Matt? Have I?
Touch the screen and then to the bottom.
Which screen? This screen. The one I covered up with the keyboard. That one. Okay. Ah, now I can't read my script. Yeah, I've got it on red mode. Here we go. Righty ho. Okay. Thanks, Jane. Jane saves me from saying probably the first 5 minutes of what I was going to say about the academic context and thinking of this, but I'll probably still say it, but a lot more quickly. This isn't a conventional kind of lecture in the sense that I'm not going to go into a great deal of detail about the underlying French philosophy or critical theory behind this work. And Jane's already mentioned Henri Lefebvre, who I think I quote once or twice in this talk. It's a kind of celebration for me, I hope for you, of the publication of this book. And as Jane says, I'm going to, quite a lot of what I'm going to say is not me talking, I'm going to show you some of my favourite film clips. And there are some buttons in front of you, and maybe if you press the buttons or something, it'll tell us which are your favourite film clips at the end of it as well. We'll see. Some thanks first. I'm really grateful to Jane, obviously, for her opening remarks, but I'm really thankful to Reaktion for publishing this book and publishing in a way which I think is quite different to the way an academic publisher might normally publish a book like this, both in terms of its design and in, to some extent, in the way that it's written. So thanks to Vivian and Michael and Maria and everyone at Reaktion for publishing the book. I've really enjoyed the process with them. Thanks to Barry Curtis and Stephen Barber, who were very instrumental in introducing me to Reaktion. Thanks to the Bartlett. A lot of the funding for this book came, all the funding that was needed for this book came from the Architecture Research Fund at the Bartlett School of Architecture. And it wouldn't have happened without the Bartlett, it wouldn't have happened without UCL. And I'm really incredibly grateful to the Bartlett for that. And thanks to all my colleagues and students at the Bartlett that I've talked about this book with over 10 years, something like that. So, lots of people are thanked at the back of the book in the acknowledgements. But thanks also to all the other people that suggested films. It's one of those topics that if you say to people, oh, I'm doing a book on car driving and it's particularly about film, someone immediately says, have you seen this? Have you seen that? And so on. Thanks particularly to everyone at Shepherd Robson, who I've probably had more suggestions from people there than anywhere else. So thanks very much to them. Thanks to my son, Sam, who isn't here, because halfway through he'd be complaining because it was not his telly that's up on the screen. But he nonetheless, I think, has been one of my inspirations in realising that films about car driving are still kind of cool and exciting. And thanks to Claire, who this book is dedicated to. Okay, this is not a book about cars. It's a book about driving. That's the first thing to say. It's about the way that cities are experienced after architects and planners and building professionals have done their thing, and all the ways in which people experience cities after that moment of construction. And as Jane pointed out, this reaches back to the work that I've done with Jane back in the mid-90s with Strangely Familiar. So this is part of the kind of the wide project. Oddly, though, when anyone looks at the history of automobile driving, well, there isn't really one. There are odd bits in car magazines. There are people have talked about quite a lot about car design. People have written odd books about road movies in particular, like California that we see here. But there is, until now, no kind of comprehensive or extended history of the experience of cities and architecture through driving as an act, as an action, as opposed to a set of designed objects. And as I say, this is also a book about film history. And it's interesting to hear Jane's thoughts about this book in relation to film history. But it's certainly, the films are used to kind of in three ways. One is which they're kind of an evidence for how people drive. But that perhaps is the most prosaic and the least interesting. They're also used as a way of thinking about how people represent and imagine driving experiences. And they're also, I think, interesting. One of the things I've got that was interesting is the way that when we drive, or when we, to some extent, passenger, as we see here in the film Killers from the 60s, how our driving experiences appear to us in cinematic terms. So it's a kind of shuttling between reality and imagination and mediation. I looked at about 450 films to do this book. It's a hard life, it's a hard job, but someone's got to do it. Here they all are. So if you mentioned one to me, you probably can't read it, but it's up there somewhere. Not all of these made it into the book, about half of them did. But and I own a DVD copy, or, well, I don't, the Bartlett owns a DVD copy of every single one of these. So if anyone wants to borrow one, ask me. It's arranged in four parts. There's a chapter on cities, there's a chapter on journeys, there's a chapter on motorways, there's a chapter which I called Altered States. And just to give you an indication of the stuff that's in here. In cities, I deal with notions of democracy, whether it's in terms of class in the grapes of wrath, or in ethnicity in Driving Miss Daisy. I'm interested particularly in notions of gender and of female independence in films like The Fast Lady and Vendredi Soir. There's some stuff about alienation and negotiation. It's not all about the pleasures of driving, although there's quite a lot about this. In this is Bohram Sarret, The Cart Man, one of the very first Senegalese films from the early 1960s, or Michael Mann's Collateral, set in LA. There is stuff about adventure and fun and the Italian job in all its different versions. There are things in here about experimentalist and avant-garde films from Reagan, a film about rain in the 1920s, through to something like A13, a psychogeographic film by William Rayburn. And there are things about urban conditions, be they things like anticipation or city mapping. That's Chinatown, Polanski at the bottom. The film at the top is Robbery by P.T. Yates, whose next film was Bullet. And I think it's one of the great films set in London in the 1960s, and it's not terribly well known. So if you're looking for a film to borrow from my vast DVD collection, I recommend Robbery. Journeys. A lot of what I say in Journeys is to do with kinesthetics, and actually most of what I talk about this evening is going to be about that, the kind of the visual pleasures of driving, and I'll come back to that. But also in Journeys, which is about speeds of around 50 to 55 miles an hour, there is, as you could imagine, quite a lot about road movies and about existentialist concerns with the self, be they in a film like Duel, Steven Spielberg's first film, a straight-to-TV film made in the 1970s, or Wim Wenders' Paris, Texas. Or films in which people are reconfigured, Antonioni's Passenger or Ridley Scott's Thelma and Louise. Or really nihilistic existentialist films like Vanishing Point, or perhaps most extreme of all, Two Lane Blacktop, which is a film not so much about nihilism, but actually is nihilistic to watch. And I thought I'd better not show you a film clip of that tonight, because it wouldn't set a very celebratory mood. But it's a great film once you get into the right frame of mind. Motorways, or what I call motopia. I'm not going to say too much about this right now, because again, I'm going to talk about it a little bit more later. But I look at the way in which films are, at the end of that chapter, I also look at the way films are filmed and the different kind of cinematic techniques. And in particular, one of the films I look at very briefly is this film noir by Joseph H. Lewis called Gun Crazy from 1949. And one of the most celebrated sequences in cinematic history for a film student, one of the films you would be shown, is a clip that I'm just going to show you in a minute, which is 3 minutes and 15 seconds in a single take. And what we're doing is we're watching these two characters, Barton and Annie, played by John Dahl and Peggy Cummins, and they're going on a bank robbery. And we go with them in From the Back of the Car, in which we both ride as a kind of an accomplice and watching. So we're both driving and watching in the cinema at the same time. And I think it's one of the more extraordinary sequences that I found about, well, in this case, it isn't about driving, it's about being passengered. But I'm going to show it to you.
Now it's his next turn, so take it easy. Here comes a car. Which leg?
That's the longest film clip I'll show you. Most of them are a lot shorter than that. Obviously, one of the things that's interesting with that, apart from the technique, is the fact that it is the kind of the way in which it shows driving, and it shows driving as framed by the windscreen, and it shows driving as a cinematic experience. But also, I think it's very kind of, in a way, overt about the filmic technique. The camera is placed in the back of the rear seat, and in some way, we're both very aware that what we're watching is cinematic, and at the same time there's a kind of naturalism to it that suggests that we're not, and we're actually immersing ourselves in the action. And I think it's particularly that kind of in-betweenness of being present and not present, of being mediated and mediated, is one of the things that I found very interesting when I got into this work on driving and film. The last chapter in the book I call Altered States, not because it has anything to do with the film called Altered States, but because it deals with very, very high speeds, or at least imagined high speeds, or virtual speeds of 100 miles or more. that take you into strange otherworldly conditions, which might be the kind of transcendental sense of sublime stillness that you get on the banking of the Monza Grand Prix circuit in Frankenheimer's Grand Prix, or conversely the kind of psycho-sexual hell in Blue Velvet. I also got very interested in notions of transgression, and I suppose this is the closest where the book is like my old work on skateboarding, the idea of driving as being an illegal or semi-illegal act in Claude Lelouch's C'était un rendez-vous, which we see at the top, or maybe in some of the ubiquitous films of people doing crazy things in cars and motorbikes that you see in YouTube. And this is from a very famous series called Ghost Rider, which is to do with a Swedish motorcyclist who does some pretty silly things on a motorbike. I got interested in car chases, as is unsurprising, given a book about driving and film. And one of the things that emerged to me through this was how much car chases are used to frame the ideology of a police force, either as the police as being the agents of reliability and solidity and competence that you get, for example, in The Blue Lamp, or kind of manic, psychic craziness in The French Connection, which you see in the middle, or just a kind of independent cool in Bullet, which you see at the bottom. I also got interested in car chases as a way of mapping cities and introducing them as kind of labyrinthine mazes that threaten the individual. And I got interested, of course, in crashes, either in the kind of visceral gothic horror of Tarantino's Death Proof, which you see at the top, or, of course, Cronenberg's version of J.G. Ballard's Crash, where the crash is an event of voyeuristic mediation. It's always a crash is experienced not just in itself, but through voyeurism and often mediated through photography and film. There's also an overtly political interpretation of crashes, and you see this particularly in the work of filmmakers like Jean-Luc Godard, in his films of the 1960s, Pierrot Le Feu, we see at the top, or Weekend at the bottom, where the crash is presented as part of a critique of globalization, colonialism, and class. Crashes also as aspects of familial relations and teenage angst in Rebel Without a Cause or Christine. And also crashes as acts of what I call material beauty, of visual aesthetic joy. And I'll show you the Porsche at Le Mans crashing. I'll show you a clip of that at the end of this talk. And finally, in that chapter, I also look at different notions of time as offering alternative versions of past, present, and future, either in Les Choses de la Vie or Final Destination 2. Which is a much underrated film involving. I'm serious. It's actually a very good film. Final Destination 1 and 3, not so good. Final Destination 2, just spot on. Okay. I'm not going to try and, you know, that's a sort of an indication of what happens in the book. And what I thought I'd do for the rest of this evening, for sort of 30 minutes or so, is look at some of the visual and aesthetic delights of driving and some of the connotations of that. And I say, I'll show you quite a few film clips. So this is often referred to as kineaesthetics. The pleasures, the sensual and visual pleasures of mobile experience. And this has been rehearsed quite a lot in art history and literary disciplines. And it particularly runs through notions of the way in which through movement, and particularly through car driving, objects appear differently, we see things differently, and speed intensifying of those experiences. So I'll just quickly show an example, really, of each in turn. So firstly, the driving can make us aware of the pure sensory experience of encountering the world around us. In other words, objects appear differently. And Marcel Proust wrote a very interesting essay about this, about his experiences of being driven around in an automobile around in northern France. And he talks about the way in which the spires of French Gothic cathedrals wheel around him as he's driven through the French countryside. The clip I'm going to show you is from about 50 years later. It's François Truffaut's film, Les 400 Coups, The 400 Blows. And it's from the title sequence, and in which a very familiar object, the Eiffel Tower, starts to look very strange to us. Of course, objects appear different to us through automobile driving experiences for all different ways. And indeed, one of the obvious things, the one dominant effect, is that things that are moving appear to be immobile. So another car moving at the same speed as the driver looks like it's static because they're both moving at the same speed. Conversely, the immobile becomes mobile. That which is stationary starts to look like it's moving fast. And many writers have been struck by this visual experience. A quote from Paul Virilio, he talks about inanimate objects which, and I quote, exhume themselves from the horizon and come bit by bit to impregnate the sheen of the windshield, thus creating what Virilio calls speed pictures. One of the other aspects of kinesthetics is then that the way we see is different. What happens when we see things from driving, one of the criticisms made of driving is that, well, you don't really encounter the object around you, you don't know anything about it. Well, actually, that's kind of the point, or one of the points. That one of the things that's interesting about driving is that the kind of viewing that you do as a result is not about kind of understanding the object around you necessarily in the ways that academics or sociologists or cultural interpreters might experience or want to understand those objects, but actually you just see them for what they are. You see with your eyes rather than with your mind. Process of that has been particularly attractive to many different artists and filmmakers because it releases them from the burden of knowledge, if you like. And this is actually one of the things I talk about in relation to skateboarding and the work I've done on that. But it seems particularly clear in many forms of driving experience. In filmic terms, and you see this in films like A Man with a Movie Camera, Dieter Wertoff's films from the 1920s, which is really a film about ways of seeing. And I'm just going to show you a very, very short clip from Man with a Movie Camera, where it shows both moving and mobile and immobile objects in a split-screen format at the same time. Other forms of seeing are then also implicated in the visual driving experience, noticeably, as I've already alluded to, the way that the windscreen acts like a frame, limiting the landscape within a prescribed boundary and then converting it into this object of pleasure. And examples of this also in art are quite common, perhaps most well-known, and one of the most well-known is this painting by Matisse from 1917. As a result, driving appears, therefore, through driving, the landscape appears in cinematic terms. So you get processes of framing, sequencing, editing, unusual juxtapositions, montage, changing pace, unexplained events, unfamiliar signs, all of which is induced by this speeding, kinematic nature of driving. This is a film about a robbery in Tyneside in 1961 called Payroll. Quote from Virilio again, "The opening of the cockpit is not a simple window, it's a stage where signs of the places traversed animate themselves, a play of scenery changes composed of speed changes." My third point about kinesthetics is then that all of this is intensified through speed. Speed exacerbates the sense of strangeness, newness, and disconnectedness that you get through the act of driving. And you see this in, obviously, in very abstract terms in early abstract films like Walter Ruttmann's Opus 1, which we see here. But then you also see it in, particularly in film noir films from the late 1940s. I'm going to show you a clip now from a film called The Killers, Robert Siodmuk's classic film noir from 1946, in which what's happening is we're riding with two hitmen as they're going to the house of someone they're about to kill. And it's, again, it's the opening sequence of the film. And there's hardly anything on the screen. It's just a set of moving kind of light patterns, but which is intensified by the sense of speed, and which I think emphasizes this sense of, in this case, of mystery, drama, and impending murder. One of the other ways, then, that speed, though, can also, I think, intensify psychological states is when it's used, obviously, in the context of other artistic constructs. And you see this in Man Ray's Emek Bakia and his Les Mystères du Château d'Oudet, experimental films from the 1920s, where changing and vibrating vision from a moving automobile is used to explore Dada and surrealist concerns with chance and with dreams and sexuality and the Freudian subconscious. What's happening here, then, is that it seems to me that the kinesthetics of driving reorients the experience of time and space, where sight, senses, intellect, landscape, meaning, creativity, and physiology of the human body are all potentially reconfigured through this one human and machinic act. One of the people I got very interested in was an early Edwardian motorist called A.B. Filson Young, who wrote a book called The Complete Guide to Motoring, or The Complete Motorist Guide. And he's got some very interesting things to say about driving. This is 1904. He says, "Automobile driving, quote, flattens out the world, enlarges the horizon, loosens a little the bonds of time, sets back a little the barriers of space." And he goes on to say that the driver simply, quote, lives more quickly. If these are some of the more, if you like, generic driving conditions of driving kinesthetics, I want to just move now to look at them in terms of cities and then motorways. And of course, one of the most off-sited aspects of urban driving is the reduction of city form to signs, to signals, to billboards, and to lights. So car driving tends to render the city as a matter of surfaces and the purely visual. And we see celebrations of this, actually, in the work, obviously, of Venturi, Eisenhower and Scott Brown in Learning from Las Vegas in 1972, which celebrates the roadside architectures of and their qualities of decorative symbolism, of ordinary repetition, their large-scale visibility. So this is a kind of urbanism where signification triumphs over space. It's about signs rather than space, and is largely understood as an architecture that you experience from the automobile, not entirely, but to quite a large degree. And then, of course, conversely, there are many people who argue against this kind of reduction of cities to signs. From the propagandist documentary The City, Ralph Steiner and Willard Van Eyck, 1939, or in a very kind of overtly anti-signal and anti-governmental attitude, this montage of images from Alphaville by Jean-Luc Godard, where the dystopian city of Alphaville is introduced to us as a set of flashing streets and streetlights and arrows and signs and equations. And I'm sure as many of you know, what's happening in this sort of dystopian world is that emotion is being erased and society is being controlled by an unforgiving computer. And these kind of automobile experiences of signs and signals equate with that. So in this kind of city, as French philosopher Henri Lefebvre noted just a few years before Godard's films, signs are reduced to signals, meanings are reduced to instructions. They then directly instruct us in what to do. Lefebvre worked as a taxi driver in Paris for a couple of years, and maybe he was remembering this experience when he wrote that, quote, "I am conditioned by signals. I behave as they tell me to behave." And of course, you see quite a lot of this then going back to films in the kind of sign-induced stress of William Foster, played by Michael Douglas, at the start of Joel Schumacher's film Falling Down. And I'll show you a clip of this. He's in a traffic jam. It's not a pleasant traffic jam. He goes off to blow up half of LA after this. So. Okay. So from this perspective, when we drive, the signs we see and must obey are not only a regulation of urban independence, but they're actually a strong contributor to a mounting sense of frustration, alienation and malevolence. You know, wrong way, go back. You know, these kinds of signs suggest that we're not only going the wrong way in our cars, but maybe we're going the wrong way in our lives as well. And everything is denied us. However, despite the undoubted, I think, nature of some of these alienating conditions, and anyone that's ever driven through a city, I think, will recognise some of these things, there are other ways of looking at this as well. And driving certainly adds something, another rhythm to urban life that we see in abstract terms in something like Fernand Léger's Ballet Mécanique, or we see in more obvious and documentary form in a film like Walter Ruttmann's Berlin Symphonie der Großstadt, where automobiles and automobile driving are seen to add one more rhythm, one more layer within the symphony of city rhythms. motorways. So if these are some of the visual experiences of urban or city driving, what about motorways? What about auto routes and autostrada and freeways and autobahns? And as we all know, many designers and planners, like Le Corbusier, have enthusiastically imagined cities based around cars and freeways. From Corb to Fritz Lang's Metropolis of 1927, right through to, this is a Steven Spielberg depiction of Washington in the year 2054 in his version of Minority Report. Perhaps most notable of all of these imaginations of a motorway world, though, is this kind of part exhibition, part film, designed by Norman Bell Geddes called Futurama, which was a giant 3,500 square meter set of diorama models put in a huge pavilion for General Motors at the 1939 World's Fair. It had hundreds of thousands of model trees and cars and buildings and so on. And you can see one of those dioramas at bottom right. And people sat in this darkened pavilion and sat in one of these chairs which moved around the dioramas. And there were speakers in these winged ears of the chairs with a kind of synchronized narration of what they were seeing. So it was a very cinematic presentation of the exhibition that they were seeing. And what the dioramas showed was a kind of utopian future America where everything was modern. And everything meant cities, agriculture, industry, research, and of course also freeways or highways. And there was a film made about Futurama called Two New Horizons, which was toured around America. And in a way, many people saw this exhibition not directly, as we see here, but through the kind of film which I'm about to show you a short clip of.
Here is a highway intersection, highway engineering at its most spectacular. Traffic may move safely and easily without loss of speed. By means of the ramped loops, cars may make right and left turns at rates of speed up to 50 miles per hour. Safe distance between cars is maintained by automatic radio control. Curved sides assist the driver in keeping his car within the proper lane under all circumstances. The keynote of this motorway, safety. Safety with increased speed.
If only. Whatever happened to that future? Well, one of the things that happened to that future is explored in people who look at actual driving experiences on real motorways. And actually, there are very few, given how prevalent the act of driving is on motorways around the world, on freeways and autostrada and autoroutes and other of these really quite amazing spaces. There's very little that's been written about them. Peter Merrifield's book on the M1 motorway, called Driving Spaces, is one of the few studies, in this case, of a single motorway of the M1, which is a fantastic book, one of the great books on driving and indeed on roads. But it's only about one motorway. In terms of exploring also what driving experiences are, one of the few films to really do this is this film, London Orbital, from 2000, directed by the filmmaker and also film critic Chris Pettit, working with Ian Sinclair, the psychogeographic writer. And this shows or explores the notion of motorways as placeless and offering a truly immersive experience, a kind of world of endless physical spaces and time. It's quite a curious film. It's part documentary and part experimental journey. And Pettit drove around the M25 motorway around London, which is 117 miles of almost, not quite, but almost unbroken circular road for days on end, filming it. And then actually he had to use another cameraman to do this because I think he couldn't pursue it for too long. But after doing this, what gradually became evident is that for Pettit, at least, the M25 wins, and that any attempt to defeat the dead time or energy drain of the motorway is doomed to failure.
More than other motorways, the M25 is designed to test thresholds of boredom. It eliminates any romantic notion of boredom, but for the addictive, it has its attractions. It is mainline boredom. It is true boredom, a quest for transcendental boredom, a state that offers nothing except itself, resisting any promise of breakthrough or story. The road becomes a tunneled landscape, a perfect kind of amnesia.
Now, it's interesting, Pettit talks in here about, you know, he kind of started off trying to imagine the motorway as offering a kind of transcendental experience of boredom, and actually at the end of the film he says that this doesn't happen, and that search does not reach a kind of satisfactory conclusion in that respect. He doesn't get transcendental boredom, and instead what he gets, and I quote, "Road is nightmare, road is purgatory, road is hell." And he says he's left with nothing but inertia and dissolution. But there have also, of course, been other celebrations and inquiries of motorway visuality. And indeed, the very distinctive visual regime of motorways is something that some people have explored and celebrated from the moment when autobahns are first produced in Germany in the interwar period, where new views, open roads and high speeds, in this case, were used to express progress into a modern German future. And after the war, when motorways are built all over the world, to summarise that, you get things like this, which is a book by the urban designers Donald Appleyard, Kevin Lynch and John R. Meyer, called The View from the Road. And what this book did was it codified the visual experience of freeway driving into a series of events, including cinematic conditions of such as sequencing, forward-facing vision, transitions, overlapping, the layering of spaces, the recall of events that you've just seen. And they even developed this very elaborate notation system for a driver's passage down the road. So I won't go into this, but it's each of these arrows or moments is about seeing different things or different marks or different notations. And their idea was that motorways and freeways would be designed using this kind of scenographic technique or aid. Now, of course, this didn't really happen, and their cinematic notation wasn't taken up. Because it didn't stop other people from admiring freeways for their aesthetic and experiential qualities. And we've already noted how learning from Las Vegas, in some extent, is about a automobile experience of the world around us. Other people in the 1970s were doing similar things. The British architectural critic Rainer Banham was celebrating the freeways of Los Angeles, which he described as having, and I quote, canonical and monumental form. And he said these were equivalent to the streets of Baroque Rome and the boulevards of Haussmann's Paris. In particular, he singled out this intersection, the intersection of the Santa Monica and San Diego freeways, as a complex piece of art which had to be appreciated not just as if it was a pattern on a map, or what he called a monument against the sky, although it is extraordinary for those reasons, but actually for the kind of experience of swooping over that intersection and along freeways. So it's the kinetic experience as well as the object. It's not just the object, it's the act of driving which releases the aesthetic qualities of these places. And interestingly, an image for Jonathan here, something from the Smithsons, A.S. in D.S. Alison Smithson, A.S., in her car, Citroen D.S., D.S., writing a book, A.S. in D.S., whose planform is in the shape of a Citroen D.S. Got enough puns in there? But what it is, it's a reading of the motorways and dual carriageways of Britain. And she talks about how this automobile-centred world generates a place of possibilities and what she called a new aspect of England. And it's a very, very interesting and I think much underread and underappreciated book. Going back to films, you start to see this in films from the 1950s and 1960s. And I'm just going to show you a clip now from Louis Malle's film, Lift to the Scaffold, 1956. And actually one of the very first cinematic depictions of this atmospheric aesthetic quality of motorway driving. The young couple we're about to see, they've stolen a car and they've driven out of Paris to one of the new auto routes, and they're just kind of driving up and down aimlessly, enjoying the qualities of the road. So, I mean, in this film, the motorway is shown as a strange alien environment, and there are lots of records of people going on day trips or Sunday afternoon trips in the UK and other countries just to experience that kind of extraordinary new landscape. There's lots of things about people in Britain just going and driving up and down the M1 just to experience this kind of amazing new clean, minimalist visual regime, the like of which they had never seen before. And then, of course, you get films which celebrate this in a look into that kind of space and find all kinds of rich and pluralistic visual conditions within it. And I'm just going to show you a short clip now from Jacques Tati's film Trafic, from 1971, which I think shows some of this in a kind of rhythmic manner. Perhaps, though, one of the most, I think, extraordinary depictions of this freeway visuality comes from another film by Chris Pettit, this time Radio On, a film released in 1979. It's a kind of an atmospheric road movie. It's about a character called Robert, who lives in London and has discovered that his brother has died in Bristol. And he drives out along the A4 and the M4 in order to find out what's happened to his brother. And it's got all kinds of interesting visual effects in it, some of which you see here. But it's the one at bottom right that I'm going to show you a film clip of now, which is the kind of hypnotic effect of a single perspective view held for quite a long period of time. I'll just show you a bit of it as Robert drives down the M4 motorway, accompanied by Kraftwerk's Radioactivity. As this scene from Radio On suggests, another distinct aspect of motorways is the way they present time as being endless, which we see, for example, in the paintings of an American artist, Alan D'Arcangelo, or we see in paintings, this goes by via Selmans, talking about the way in which motorways seem to suspend time and allow people a form of urban meditation. What's going on here is a very, I think, a strange visual and psychological thinking space that occurs through the body of the driver and the nature of the road and the visual experience that they've got in front of them. And in short, motorway driving, the relatively extended periods of time where you're kept alert by the fact that you need to keep alert, normally, but in a way not much happens, allows people to enter a state of contemplation and thinking in a way that perhaps they don't have space or time to do in other parts of their existence. And to cite but one example of this in film, I'm going to show you a clip or a montage of two clips from Hitchcock's Psycho. And this was first brought to my attention by one of our students at the Bartlett, where we all know Psycho for its shower scene, but before then, before she gets to Bates Motel, Marion Crane, played by Janet Leigh, has stolen some money. And she's driving away, imagining what people are thinking about her. She's swapped cars, so she's recalling the conversation she's had when she's sold her old car too cheaply and just bought another one. And she's imagining what her employer and other people will say about her. And the reason she's doing this is because, in a way, she doesn't... Obviously, there's something going on in her mind about this. She's just done something that she wasn't really thought she was going to do. But it's the nature of driving. It's the nature of the dual carriageway-like road with very few distractions, very few turn-offs, that gives her the space and time to think about all this.
$700 in cash.
Yes, Mr. Lowry.
Carolyn? Nine still, isn't it?
No, Mr. Lowry, but then she's always a bit late on Monday mornings.
Buzz me the minute she comes in. Call her sister. No one's answering the house.
I called.
It doesn't end well. The opposite of kinesthetic joy or contemplation, which is to say that driving can be accompanied by crashes, or at least the perceived risk of crashes. And of course this is pursued by artists like Kainholz or Warhol, or by Dean Rogers, who did this series of large-scale photographs of the sites at which famous celebrities died in car crashes. So this is a photograph of the site of the death of Jackson Pollock, or motorcycle and car crashes. But more generally, though, what we find in car cultures is celebrated not death or serious injury, but rather the way in which crashes are normally, not always, but normally followed by a kind of rebirth, that the crash is part of a cycle between near death or a challenge to life, followed by life again. And I'm going to show you a clip now from the film Le Mans, 1971, Lee Katzin, which is a semi-documentary, narrative film. Steve McQueen plays the part of Delaney. He drives a Porsche 917 and has a crash. And we're going to join this at the moment at which he's just had the crash and relives the moment and, in a way, focuses on how he has survived the extraordinary crash which he's just had.
There is that.
what does this mean then for driving in cities, roads and landscapes? Well, one of the things that seems to me is important about this is if we are to deal with issues of congestion, pollution, energy consumption, health and safety, all these things that are incredibly important to do with car usage and driving, most of which I entirely ignore in this book, then we have to consider, and there are reasons for doing that, is that we must consider what the pleasures of driving are. That we need to understand, if we want to tempt these people out of their cars, as perhaps we should do at some times, then we need to have an understanding of what those pleasures are. People will not leave their cars without replacing those pleasures or having recompense to those pleasures instead. You know, and one extreme version of this is to say, well, maybe we shouldn't drive for necessity at all, and we should only drive for moments of pure pleasure. Perhaps more realistically, we need to think about how do we take some of the values and qualities which we see on the right and think about what those automobile experiences might be like if we allow them in other forms of transportation and other forms of movement. But all the while, we have to remember that people will not be too willing to forego the pleasures of driving, on which I think this book, Drive, tries particularly to inquire into. And indeed, we see this throughout the whole history of driving. So we see it in a very, very early film. This is, it's The Question Mark Motorist, so it's The Question Motorist, from very early 1900s, a film about Edwardian motorists who resist the forces of the police and engage in frivolous and adventurous driving, all the way through to a character like Poppy in Mike Leigh's Happy-Go-Lucky, who is determined to drive. And I'll show you this last but one clip. What we see here is Poppy, who's being berated by her depressive, annoying, dominating driving instructor. She's determined nonetheless to acquire and enjoy the skills of driving.
You're smug. You're too easily distracted. You're distracted by squirrels, by dogs, by children in the park, by old ladies in surgical stockings, by half-naked babies in gardens.
Oh, well, it was worth it, wasn't it?
No, he wasn't fit. He had a crutch.
I didn't know checking out some kidneys.
All you have to do is keep your eyes focused on the road. This car is a lethal weapon. If you don't pay attention, you're going to kill somebody. Keep to the left and centre of the road.
Come on, Scott, how often do you see a squirrel sending a text like that?
Better. I can't believe you're a teacher. I can't believe they have put you in charge.
No, she's very bad surprised, to be honest. It's 30.
30. You have no respect for order. You are arrogant, you're disruptive, and you celebrate chaos.
I slipped through the net, didn't I?
No, you are the net. Believe you me, Poppy, you are the net. Poppy, have to look at your next left turn. Mirror signal maluma. Enra ha. Keep with it, Poppy. Okay.
It's worth pointing out, at the end of the film, it's Poppy who learns to drive, and she's telling Mike that he shouldn't drive. She's the one that reverses the relationship and controls the act of driving. So I think it's worth underlining here that despite the kind of seemingly irreverent kind of frippery in Happy-Go-Lucky, what this film shows, and other people have argued, is that driving complements our autonomy. Encourages that positive self-directing impulse that is valued, or very often valued, in our contemporary society. And in a way, then, my sort of concluding point about this is that driving, and indeed other activities like it, are part of that kind of modern sense of autonomy and self-directing impulse. And all the other things which I hope that the book Drive does is to show that there are pleasures in driving which we can enjoy and perhaps then should celebrate and perhaps even encourage. I'm going to leave you with one last film clip, which I think is one of the most preeminent cinematic explorations of urban city driving, which is from Martin Scorsese's magisterial Taxi Driver from 1976. And actually, I think it shows those of you who've seen the whole film, know the whole film, as many of you, I'm sure, will understand this context even more, actually both the pleasures and the challenges of car driving. So it shows both dark menace and aesthetic beauty, social alienation, and also a sense of liberation, enclosure and movement. Taxi driver.
I suppose one of the things that I was also interested in is the way in which, you know, we all watch films as from the age of 4 or 5 up. And it's the way in which films that you see when you're young and also old films which you see now still affect your understanding and experience of urban space. So I challenge anyone who hasn't seen Steven Spielberg's film Duel, which is, you know, where this character man drives across the desert and for no reason whatsoever, a petrol tanker harries him across the landscape and suddenly appears in his rear view mirror and nearly pushes it into a train and tries to run him off the road and so on. This is a film made in 1971. If you watch that film now, 40 years later, and then the next day you go and drive on the motorway and suddenly a petrol tanker appears behind you, you will not, you know, you cannot not rethink your driving experiences through that mediated experience. And I think one of the interesting things about, I suppose it's about watching films now, is that they have that power to leap, you know, historical, across time over there. So I suppose, as we, you know, all do in writing these things or exploring these things, I suppose what I was, in a way, I was trying to unpack was all the films that I've seen prior to doing this book. Although obviously I looked at a lot of new other ones as well, and try and think about how they, you know, if you watch the Berlin Symphony of a City, actually you get a cab on the way home. You'll view the city again, and of course it's like artwork, you know, they, as works of art. And yet at the same time, of course you're right, they're also historically specific. And there is, I think, a I don't know if it's interesting or difficult aspect of the book, but the films are used both, as I said at the start, as evidence and as imaginative constructions and as possible influences on the way we understand driving now.
Yeah.
And, you know, if it were a PhD thesis, you'd have to unpack that a lot more. But I haven't.
No, but so it was something because, that I hadn't really thought about. I didn't want to either. Reading the book, it was more seeing the clips of the films. And then at the end, I mean, as most people know, I don't drive, and I think that's probably a very good thing for everyone. And I think my learning to drive experience was not unlike Poppy in the sense of perhaps a slightly distracted driver. So I'm just thinking from the view more of someone who perhaps doesn't drive and is quite often on a bike experiencing driving, and thinking about the comment that you've made concerning the discourse that's out there that is very much a kind of anti-driving discourse about the dangers of driving, or the lack of community, the environmental commentary and stuff. And that's the discourse that, in a way, that you, I think you said that this book is a riposte book in many ways. And I'm just wondering then what the implications are of thinking driving through pleasure, and whether that the book offers a possibility for those who are perhaps quite critical of driving to understand better in order to...
I don't think it's also about driving better. Mm-hmm. I think it's about understanding, like you're saying, that there are pleasures in driving which we need to understand, even if you want, as it were, stop it.
Yeah.
Then you need to understand the thing that you're railing against or concerned with. And I'm both a driver and not a driver. As everyone may know, I'm a very keen driver. But I'm also a cyclist, I'm also a skateboarder, and I'm also a pedestrian, and I'm also someone that worried that my young child is going to get run over by an errant idiot, you know, trying to emulate Claude Lelouch's Say to Her Robin. I'm all those people. So it's partly, it was just about that kind of academic context. Well, surely we need to understand the pleasures. But also, it's a thing about, well, you know, there are things of value in those pleasures that we shouldn't underestimate, either in themselves or how they might need to be replicated or put somewhere else if we were to get rid of driving.
Well, I suppose it has. I mean, I was thinking when I was trying to describe in the introduction the readership of the skateboarding, but there are also those who are, you know, kind of anti-skateboarding, who feel that it gets in the way, can knock over vulnerable people, and so on. So I suppose with the drive book, you've also got the potential of quite a contentious readership, and if people were to use the book as a counter discourse, I suppose you would be open to that, in the sense that a reader's content in whatever direction they may
wish. Of course,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay, has anyone else got anything they'd like to ask or discuss with Iain?
Yeah.
Hi, thank you for that. That was really good. And there were some points of departure there, which, you know, lots and lots of great things to pick up on there. So, yeah, fantastic. Thank you. One of them I just wanted to sort of pick up on was there seems to be almost a contention between the visualization, the mediation of the driving, and all the different kind of clips that you show between the sort of claustrophobic, perhaps striation of the urban environment for driving, positive perhaps against the sort of freedom, perhaps smooth space, maybe the Deleuze-Guattari kind of dichotomy going on. In all the sort of in the vast amounts of visual material that you have kind of today, can you speak more to that contestation? Does one win out, perhaps, in the way in which driving has been visualised, particularly in Hollywood, perhaps, or in
I mean, the interesting, I'd speak about the context of driving in London. I don't drive in London now. I try not to. I do the school run occasionally, and I try. I think that the one that wins out is the alpha deal. The falling down, the congestion, the pollution. I don't see why anyone would drive in London except at kind of 3 o'clock in the morning. If they brought a mini. I actually think the reality of most urban driving is the conflictual, alienated one. And actually, that's probably why I spent slightly longer talking about the pleasures of motorway driving. And actually the kind of the distance that gives you from the pressure cooker of cities today. It may be different in many other cities. But the interesting thing though is of course that car driving is still promoted in the forms of adventure and fun. So if you watch almost any advert for a city car, a small Toyota or a Mini or something, actually, what they nearly all do is replicate the scenes from the Italian Job, which I didn't show, where you've got lots of playful minis dashing around the city like kind of eager puppies, having play and fun and adventure and games. And that's how urban car driving is actually marketed and represented. But the reality is different. But nonetheless, I'm sure people absorb that. Every time you drive across London, there's kind of an unfulfilled wish that it will be like, driving a Mini Futura in and getting away with it. And of course, it's never like that, or hardly ever like that.
But it's interesting to mention advertising, what you're saying, because it's almost as if...
Which is something I touch on a bit, but don't get into. I do in relation to the city driving.
And is that something that would interest you more? Do you imagine this might continue in future work? Would you look at the other forms of representation of driving, or is it film that's the more...
I don't know. I mean, there is more work that's already been done on advertising and media and cars. So that is an academic literature and cultural studies literature that exists. I probably wouldn't. I actually really don't want to write about cars.
Yeah,
and advertising. Any other questions? Yeah,
at the back.
What's
been your most inspirational driving
experience?
Sorry.
No. How long have you got? The only picture I showed of that's the only picture I showed of real driving. In there, there was a picture of me driving at one point in there, probably the most. I don't know if it's inspirational, but the one that made me most feel most alive is driving around the Nürburgring, which is, for those of you who know, is a 13-mile racetrack come private road in Germany that you have to pay to drive around. It's legally classed as a public road, but in effect it's a racetrack.
And it's speed.
It's a lot of speed, and there's an awful lot of danger. And Claire sat there, who did it with me, and we both came off the track in two laps, and in two laps we saw two crashes, including the Toyota turned over on its roof. And we got off the track and drove back, that's enough, never again. And then within 24 hours we were driving back on the German Autobahn to London, and we both sort of looked and went, well, maybe I could do that again. Because it's about that kind of incredible challenge of being alive and yet surviving. And I have since been back to the Nürburgring and been around it again. So I think that's one kind, which is the that real sense of exhilaration, which I suppose in some ways is close to the skateboarding kind of stuff. Yeah. But the other one I'd say is almost any motorway drive. I love motorway driving, and I know Jane doesn't. And I like that sense of just being and just thinking. And maybe it's because, you know, the phone doesn't ring, or it can't ring, or your emails can't go, you know, and you haven't got something you don't want on telly in the background. It's a space, but maybe that says something about my inability to relax. But I do relax when I'm driving on motorways. And I like long journeys for that reason. If you said to me now, I've got a package and I need to deliver it to Northern Scotland, would you take it? Yeah, I'll be there. No, thanks. Yeah, I love it. Can I?
Yeah, I mean, part of the reason I can't bear it is because, and perhaps it says something about my own state of mind, is I'm constantly imagining wheels spinning out of control and the whole thing.
You said to me that, you know, I know Jennifer said to me that, you know, Jim Park went on a drive and he said, we spent the whole weekend on the motorway, we are kind of knuckles clenched in terror at the speed. And I'm sure I've been in the car behind him. I'm so chilled, I'm so relaxed. And, you know, people have different jobs.
Different pleasures. Any other questions? I think there was someone else.
Thank you for this. And what seems to come out of the good remarks in the discussion of the issue, I think one possible dimension of driving that I want to explore is more maybe you do it more imaginary dimension. And I was also wondering, since you've been working mostly with your film, whether you could use, for example, science fiction videos, this kind of modern, how driving this kind of modern experience like advances for teaching a kind of supermodern experiences and visions.
It's interesting, there are obviously science fiction films that I looked at, like Minority Report. Actually, they're not very interesting, because they're too fictional. And in a way, the things that I find most enjoyable are things that are kind of, you know, they're near real, as it were. Which is why I started off, I think, with that clip from Going Crazy, which is kind of super real. In that the reason why Super Real had very low budget, so they just did it in one take, so that's all they could afford to do, kind of thing. But also it's incredibly otherworldly, because you're engaged in a slightly surreal bank heist, and that for various reasons they're dressed in cowboy clothes. It's sort of every day and non-every day at the same time. So I probably wouldn't go into sort of super fictional things, because I'm not so interested. You know, they seem to move away from reality.
Any other questions?
On a lighter end, I'm just curious to know whether either of you have broken a red light or sighting on.
Oh yeah, it's frequently. Jane?
No, I'm very, very cautious.
Actually, not regularly. Actually, when I cycle, 99 times out of 100, I'm very red lights, but not always.
There's no more on them up there.
Yeah.
I'm glad.
I used to work as a bus courier for a kid, so I've had a fair bit of experience of that. And obviously, you know, I drive and I cycle. Mostly take public transport, actually. But I mean, there's issues about, obviously, you know, what we're speaking about is issues of transgression and obeying rules. And, you know, clearly, you know, people do break rules from driving all the time, but not red lights, not so much so.
Well, the intention of wearing the rules are not very serious. But it's one of them very much. Very serious. It's not so serious. This is a last question.
I didn't see the research.
My wife's been knocked down twice. She uses buses all the time. She's pedestrian. She's frightened now.
Yeah.
She works at West End.
I
can't believe her
else. Yes.
Just got a question about what you ended with, talking about this notion of autonomy, and in what I'm sort of doing in my thesis right now, looking at how we experience landscapes through our journeys, and obviously it's very relevant, but I was wondering if you could talk about sort of this notion of how driving is a sort of liberating experience linked to sort of, I don't know, our notions of democracy and almost just sort of having the right to be able to escape and to engage with the landscape in a sort of in that metaphysical kind of way.
The bit I get to in the book about this is particularly in the context of urban driving, particularly talking about the car as an instrument which provided, well, what I talked about in relation to the Grapes of Wrath is that it provided, well, obviously in that film, the capacity for people to move from one part of America to another and survive. And it's a car on freedom or survival or existence. But also, particularly, one of the things, well, it's interesting, one of the tropes in films, at least, is that cars are figured as an agent of liberation for women. It's very gendered. And particularly in the 1960s and 70s, it's rarely figured actually as an agent in gender terms for men. It's just sort of there. But when it's actually explicitly focused on, it's gendered in relation to the abilities of someone like the female character of Fast Lady, or indeed Thelma and Louise, about providing kind of an independence and a mobility. So it basically attaches spatial mobility to social mobility. The points in Driving Miss Daisy are about the access of Black Americans and Afro-Americans to, again, to mobility and to enable them to experience landscapes that they wouldn't otherwise have had access to. I think those are quite particularly historic arguments, and go back to your point about history, and they're also quite geographically focused, you know, because they're things to do with American and US society. I think there is a thing about that I think cars do, which in a way it's similar to the things that airplanes do. You can talk about the environmental effects of airplanes, I know my colleague is interested in. Is, you know, the idea that the underestimated, I think sometimes simple things of what these instruments enable you to do that you would not otherwise be able to do. In terms of where you can go and what you can see and what you can experience. And maybe that's in a very libertarian way. It's what I can do, where I can do, what I can see. Interestingly, the literature on motoring in the 1910s and 1920s particularly talks about cars as a form of liberation from the schedules of train timetables and train schedules. So the problem with the train is the train will leave then, it will get there at this time, and you can't, you know, stop off at there and there. But you can't detour, you can't change the timetable. It doesn't, there's very little spatial or temporal flexibility. And the car is as offering a way to engage with the landscape in a way that you can't do with trains. It's quite marked as to how, you know, automobile experiences are promoted that way.
But maybe the kind of interesting question that the book might prompt us to in relation to our colleague's question about the and comments, important comments also about the danger of roads, is that the kind of push or the potential that driving offers for autonomy and freedom of individual expression, then I think there has to be sort of balance with the ethical responsibility then that drivers have about perhaps looking at how they exercise those pleasures in some way.
And that's not something which this book...
It kind of comes out of the book and the discourse that it might produce. Yeah, we'll just take one more question. Thank you.
I just wanted to read from your vision of driving as something that's empowering, especially for women, and in that sense, being gendered. After this, I suppose most of you might have heard about the recent case of rape in Delhi in a public bus. So that's brought out quite a few, you know, women drivers in Delhi, like, over how they're actually feeling shackled in a car. That, you know, they wouldn't be able to go out at that particular time or, you know, part of the city if they weren't driving.
If they did not drive, you said, or, sorry, Iain, what did you mean?
If they weren't driving, like if they did not have access to a car, they probably wouldn't be going out in the city at that particular time of the day. Or so we're talking about the car as not empowerment, but rather as something that's, you know, putting them in shackles, just like in their homes. So, you know, that's what they're being at home. So I just like to hear from you about if that's part of the
You know, as far as I've explored it in this book, it's particularly in relation, as I say, to films in the 1960s that you see that happening and how that's explored filmically. I don't know if I have anything to, you know, to add to what you know the kinds of things you've said about gender and driving experiences in general. One thing that is clear though is that often it, because of those filmic depictions of gender freedom in the 60s, it's kind of assumed that women start to drive in the 1960s. Actually, they start to drive a lot earlier than that. And the reason we know they start driving from the moment car driving begins in the very late 19th century and the 1900s, but actually they drive a lot more than people think that they did in the 1910s and in the 1920s. And where you see this is actually come back to the discourse about advertising, that car manufacturers suddenly realise that the decision makers in the car purchasing process, particularly in the States, are often the women, and that they have to design cars which appeal to a female sensitivity. And there's also an argument, interestingly, that's constructed about this, that men like this, because through the agency of their wives and female partners, it offers a substitution for the violence and robustness of the industrial workplace. That actually, that the car provides a feminine corrective to the masculine domination and violence that they suffer in the industrial workplace. And there's quite an interesting kind of dialogue, a discussion in there, in the history of car advertising. It's not my favorite, it's just something I've come across. But I think what that tells us is that the prevalence of women drivers is greater than actually is represented in films. In that sense, films aren't always a very good documentary evidence, you know, for that. But they may be quite good ways of exploring the idea of female independence through driving.
Thank you very much, Iain. Thank you for answering our questions and comments, and thanks for a really enjoyable lecture. And we look forward to reading the book and having a drink with you. So if you'd like to join us for drinks and to celebrate the book, we're just going next door to the Bartlett foyer. Oh, we're going next door?
No,
yes,
it's that way.
So please join us, and thanks for coming.